Hi there, my name's Richard. I work with Chris on the development of the LeoVR app. This is a quick demonstration of the PC version. We also have an iPad and Android version which is ready to go. Although, please bear with us because this is still a production version that you're going to see today. There's quite a lot of detail missing in the room and there's a lot of lighting to be worked on still, so that some of the colours aren't going to be right, for example. And you'll see a lot of difference in the finished version. Some of you will have already seen quite a lot of this already if you're part of the Leo Steering Group, for example, but anybody part of the wider Leo Society, this is probably the first you're going to be seeing of the app overall. So a couple of years ago you will have seen the Leo photography app, which Chris used to publish over 100 photographs that he had found as part of his research into the Leo One room. Picture 87 represents what is the operational phase of the room, which is really what we've aimed as a de facto standard to be working towards, because it's the fullest example of the room in action, in use, which is very much the story that we wanted to tell. So this is the Leo VR app actually running on my PC now, and you can see that we've actually managed to get quite far down the line to recreating what you just saw on picture 87. I'm going to do a little tour for you and explain roughly our process and some of the features that have been added to the app, and just show you some of the best models that have been created and some of the detail involved. So I'm actually controlling this using a standard games controller that you might see on a PlayStation or on an Xbox, and this is going to be installed using a PC with a big display as you see it inside the museum in Cambridge. So as part of an exhibition, this is how a member of the public would interact with it. If you were using it on the iPad or an Android device, you see these joysticks on the screen. They let you move exactly in the same way as I will be with the joystick. So we've got forward, back, left, right on the left, and rotation on the right. But for the purposes of this demo, it's just a lot easier for me to be controlling it and getting out of the way of the screen. So a lot of detail has gone into creating as accurate a representation as we possibly can with this, from the basics of the structure of the room. So Chris's research indicated it was a 50-foot by 50-foot space. We've gone and created all the sash windows exactly as they were, all of the pillars placed around the room. The ceilings are actually just temporary at the moment because we've got to get the proper strip lighting working, which is going to be one of the final stages. But we've also put the floors in and worked on getting accurate materials that represent roughly what we could see in photographs. Of course, there is very little evidence of colour because the majority of what we're seeing is all black and white. So we've had to speculate on that. And there's still some work to be done on it because, for example, this wood over here you'll see is quite orange. Until the actual lights are in, there's no point really us working too hard on that because it will change radically depending on what light is falling on it. So there are roughly two sections to the room. We've got the calculator area over here, and we've got the peripheral area over on the left, and we worked roughly in that order. We worked to get all these racks in and then worked on the peripherals much more recently. So we've got 21 racks, of which two of them are open for users to explore a little bit more detail. So we've got four half adders which are available to see in this, and we can click on one of them as a user, find out a little bit more about it, and delve a bit deeper using what we're calling the object inspector. So a user can look much more detail at the object itself and so forth, and they get a chance to read far more detail about it. All that content is to come, of course. We can look at some of the other objects which are available. For example, we've got the open rack, but we've also got a valve. We can do exactly the same. You see a lot of holding images and holding text in some of this. There is some content which has been written already, but there's still a lot of writing to do in the next few months. We've worked fundamentally on the development of the application so far and the content management to control the flow of information going into it. There's still a lot of writing to be fed in. Moving on, we've got four stores here as well, which will be linked to models you can spin around as well. These control the Mercury delay lines. and we've got an oscilloscope sat in front of it that would have been used for testing. So what we're trying to do is try and build up various stories in the room where we could tell aspects of what was going on, what was being done in this room, what on earth did people do and how did they interact with this computer. So one of them is going to be testing and maintenance, and we've got some evidence of a gentleman actually standing at this specific rack using this exact same oscilloscope working on some components. So there's obviously a wider maintenance story that can be told through this space. We have at the back here, and this is one of the recently added objects, we have the engineer's console. So a lot of work's been gone into making sure this is all correct in terms of the panel. We have a bit more to be adding in. So for example, we'd like to animate some of these dials and make sure they all have their labels inserted on it as a last phase, and we'll make some of the lamps light up and so forth. But we're trying to make it as accurate as possible. We have a drawing board next to that, which is going to have a set of paper-based circuit diagrams that people can actually page through and see some genuine examples of how the half adder, for example, was drawn up for creation. And we have various desks and filing cabinets in the corner that will tell various other bits of the story. We have a full ventilation system as well modelled in, which was being used to cool all of these 21 racks, which will have emitted a huge amount of heat, as you can imagine. If you look through the photos in the photo app, you'll see that ventilation system is very accurately produced, right down to the rivets on each corner and so forth, and the materials. So a lot of detail has gone into that. We've also got the mercury delay line, the wooden mercury delay line section here, which has short delay lines on the left, including two different variants of them, with ventilation for that at the back, and all the cables running underneath the floor. And we've got the long delay lines on the right, with very similar, all the complex cables have all been modelled in, all running under the floor as well, and they're passed over to their relevant racks. So we've done a lot of work to make those models pretty accurate, but obviously standing from this sort of distance you won't see a great level of detail in them, so we're going to be quite reliant on people wanting to find out a little bit more about them, clicking through into the object inspector and having a chance to look through in detail. We also have all the peripherals, which have now been modelled fully. We've got line printers, card reader and line printer. The little caveat for this is we've still got to put a control panel on this. Same's true for all these peripherals actually, but that's going to have to go in a final stage. We've got card reader and punches and card readers and a number of sorters, two sorters at the back. We've also got the electrical switchboard, which runs and powers the whole of the room. Again, we're going to have some animation on those dials, and we're going to have some light emitted from the lamps. And we have the operator's console over here at the centre of the peripheral area. And we also have one of the paper tape readers and a drawer of paper tapes. So a number of stories about how Leo works can obviously be told in this area. We're going to be able to demonstrate some of these machines working as well, because we're going to add a layer of animation to this. So for example, you might be able to walk up to a line printer and click an icon to say play an animation and maybe see this working. So perhaps we're talking about some cards being read in and ejected out the bottom, and then some information being printed off on the right. We also have a couple of other areas that have been updated recently. We've got this administration and data processing area, which has a huge number of these card trays, of which some of them are full, some of them are empty. What we're really trying to do is give a story of data processing to explain that humans were involved in this process, unlike very much today where a computer can take on the input and output very much itself. there was a lot of human interaction involved in getting information into Leo and getting it out again. So we've also got a management area over here where we'll also be able to tell a couple of other stories about the room. And if we continue over, we've got a couple of open windows. So we can look out and see some of the scene which we've actually built, which shows some of the wider Hammersmith area and the Cadby Hall complex. So we've got Addison Mansions over here. And you can, at all points, you can rotate and see some of the London skyline. We need to add a bit more fog and make this look a bit more realistic in terms of its colour and so forth to make it a bit less perfect. But as a starting point, we've done a lot of work to research the area that was around Cadby Hall at the time and make sure this is all right. And out the other side, we can go over to this open window down here. So these windows over here show the quad side of the building. So we built the WX block in full pretty much as well, and we've developed all of the windows that you can see out here, including the glass quad roof, which can be viewed at the bottom as well. We're really trying to give people a sense of where they are in context of the wider sort of London environment. And we can use it to tell some stories about what was going on in the wider context of Leo as a company as well. So we have a few other features which we can go through quickly. So for example, we built the basic interaction of the app, including saving. We can select one of these slots and we can name it. And we can then go somewhere else in the room. And we can load it, which takes us back to our original position. And we've also got a good inventory system which has been built. So for example, if I wanted to hang on to this half adder and refer to it at a later point, so for example, if I was in part of a lesson and a teacher asked me to do a task like go and collect a specific set of 5 objects, I could add that to my inventory. And at any point then I could go and look and refer to it without having to go and find it. There it is. So most of the core functionality has been added. We've still got some key pieces to do. So we want to allow users to look at paged documents. So for example, the Lennox notebooks, we want to be able to page through those. So that's the next thing I'm currently working on. And there is some other things to do, like we need to get people into the room. We want to be able to interact with them and ask them some questions. So there is still some core functionality to do. Plus, Chris is turning a lot of his research into writing, so any of these objects you'll be able to click on and get much more meaningful information, and a lot more depth to it. We'll also be controlling where you arrive in the room. So this demonstration, I started off over in this far corner here, whereas it's much more likely, I think, that a user will be coming through one of these doors as a starting point to make a bit more sense of the room. The app as well will be led by static content. So if you imagine if you're in the exhibition at the Cambridge Museum, you'll have an exhibition around you to explain what is Leo, what were lions, what was Leo 1. So we can give users a bit more of an understanding about the context of which they're seeing this room without having to explain it all through artifacts in the room that the user may not find. I mean, our key emphasis for this app overall is about interaction. It's not a video, it's not a set of photographs. It's something that a user can walk around and define their own journey and pick out information that they feel is relevant, and they might choose to see some stuff and they might choose to not see others. So we can't guarantee that they're going to have a specific set of information when they come to this. So on the iPad version and the Android version, we're going to install what we're calling static content at the front of the app, so we can answer some of those questions. So just through some illustrations and some text, we're going to be able to explain who were lions, what was Leo 1 at a very basic level, and tell a little bit of the story, not too deep, but a little bit of it, before any user gets dropped into the room, so we can guarantee this makes sense for people. So that's a very brief overview, and a very quick tour of the room. I'm sure you'd like to see a little bit more, so I've prepared a few renders and animations from some key components from the room that we've spent a lot of detail working on, and I'm going to play them for you just directly after this clip. I really hope you enjoyed having a quick look around the Leo VR app, and any questions, please do send them to me.